So my name is Bill Wilson, and I'm very pleased to welcome you this evening, and also to welcome Kathryn, Edin, and Luke Shaefer to talk about their new book, $2 a Day, Living on Almost Nothing in America. Kathy is a Bloomberg Distinguished Professor at Johns Hopkins University and one of the nation's foremost authorities on the family, poverty, and inequality. And prior to becoming the inaugural Bloomberg Distinguished Professor at Johns Hopkins, she was my colleague, David's colleague, here at Harvard, and she served as a director of the Kennedy School's Inequality Program. And in 2014, she was elected to the National Academy of Sciences and the American Academy of Political and Social Science. Now, if you have not read any of her other books, I urge you to do so. For over two decades, Kathy has chronicled the enormous struggles facing poor, low-skilled adults and their children to make ends meet in an era of growing inequality. And it's not an exaggeration to say that with this body of work, she has impacted policy and public opinion regarding the poor more than any other contemporary social scientists working on these issues. Luke Shaefer, the co-author of $2 a Day, is Associate Professor of Social Work and of Public Policy at the University of Michigan. And Luke's numerous publications stem from research that focuses on the effectiveness of the United States social safety net in serving low-wage workers and economically disadvantaged families, the impact of the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program on material hardships, barriers to unemployment insurance faced by vulnerable workers, and strategies for increasing access to oral health care in the United States. And in my review of $2 a Day for the New York Times Book Review, I wrote that it is a remarkable book that could very well change the way we think about extreme poverty in the United States, and that it serves as a call to action. And one hopes it will accomplish what Michael Harrington's The Other America achieved in the 1960s, arousing both the nation's consciousness and conscience about the plight of a growing number of invisible citizens. As the country begins to focus on next year's presidential election, this book could not be more timely. Two decades ago, President Clinton signed a Republican-drafted welfare reform bill entitled Temporary Assistance for Needy Families, TANF, that, designed as a block grant, gave states considerably more latitude in how they spend government money for welfare than AFDC did, that is, aid to families with dependent children. And the block grant strategy has become the central plank of the Republican Party to confront poverty in America. Indeed, Mr. Paul Ryan, The new Speaker of the House has also proposed to turn Medicaid, food stamps, housing assistance, and energy aid into a block grant to the states as well. The principal exceptions would be Social Security and the Earned Income Tax Credit. And this is really distressing news for the poor. As pointed out in a report by the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities, whose Board of Trustees I sit on, Canada has not only lost more than half of its buying power because it was not designed to be adjusted for inflation, but also states were given the tools and incentives to divert the TANF funds to cover other priorities. For example, by reducing caseloads, they could circumvent the requirement to meet job participation benchmarks. The Center on Budget and Policy Priorities found that states, on average, use only about half of the funds earmarked for the core objectives of the TANF program, such as providing poor recipients with cash aid, child care, or assistance in getting jobs. Moreover, the meager funds available for welfare today are increasingly difficult to obtain. 2 decades ago, 68% of poor families with children received welfare. Today, only 26% of such families do. And in 2012, one-fifth of households reported that food stamps were their only source of income. Millions more barely scraped by with low-paying jobs and nominal assistance. Because tackling poverty has increasingly become the responsibility of the states through block grants, assistance for the poor has effectively declined while poverty in this country has become more extreme. That is why the publication of $2 a day is so timely. It raises issues that our country cannot ignore, issues that we must address now. Please join me in welcoming Kathy Edin and Luke Shaefer to talk about this important book.
I want to start by saying that we didn't go out looking for this. I was in Baltimore in the summer of 2010 interviewing young adults who had been born in public housing. And I just so happened to stumble into the house of Ashley, age 19, with a baby who was just 2 weeks old. And I immediately noticed that she was visibly unkempt. She looked depressed. She was having trouble supporting her baby's head as she rocked the baby. I soon noticed there was no food in the house and no baby formula. There was almost no furniture. And for those of you who've known me for a long time, you know at the very beginning of my career, thanks in part to my dissertation advisor, Sandy Jenks, I spent 6 years traveling the country interviewing low-income single mothers about their budgets. So this was prior to welfare reform. But I kind of had a mental calculator in my head ever since. It doesn't help me balance my checkbook, but it helps me in research. And so I began, you know, interviewing Ashley about her sources of income and her expenditures, and soon learned that there was no cash income coming to this household at all, not from TANF, not from work, and not even from food stamps. So it occurred to me, maybe, in the aftermath of welfare reform, I've been off studying other things, the family, the working poor. Maybe in the aftermath of welfare reform, a whole new group of poor had sort of arisen right under our noses, that we're experiencing a poverty so deep that we didn't even think it existed in America. What happened the next day, I think, was equally compelling. We had given her $50 at the end of the interview, and we came back the next day to make sure she and the baby were okay, because we'd been concerned. And imagine our surprise when we saw Ashley at the front door, about to leave. She had gotten a home perm. She had gone down Broadway Avenue to the Goodwill in Fells Point and gotten a pantsuit, and she was wearing it. It was as if her whole countenance had changed, and she had deposited the baby with her mother, and she was on her way to look for employment. So I think the second thought I had at this point was there something really special about cash in the most advanced capitalist society in the world? After all, many societies what we think of when we think of the rubric of $2 a day have a barter economy, that much of the economy actually exists outside of the cash economy, and of course that wasn't true here. So I basically bracketed those thoughts and finished my research, and then went back to Harvard, where I realized that I had invited Luke to come and be a visiting professor at the Wiener Center. So when Luke and I met for coffee at 8 a.m. in the morning in my office upstairs, I told him the story of Ashley, and the rest is history.
So it's fun to be able to tell the story here, because it actually happened in this building, as well as the Dunkin' Donuts across the street. So I have a very fond memory of those two places. But Kathy told me about Ashley, and she said, you know, I think there's just something different going on here. And I've been using some data from the Survey of Income and Program Participation. As a junior faculty member at the time, I considered it my one-trick pony that I did as many papers as I could off of this data set after I had paid the fixed cost of learning it. The SIP obviously is not perfect. No data sources, and certainly no household data sources. You might imagine that in some cases, when you ask people about the programs that they participate in or their income streams, they might have forgotten or be embarrassed to tell you. But the SIP registers more income among poor families than any other source we have, and reveals the most program participation in programs like TANF and SNAP and otherwise. So we thought it was the right place to start. And I had a program, and with just a few changes, I could run some preliminary numbers. And Kathy likes to say I was back the next day. It was actually about a week. And what we found, I think, really shocked us. We wanted to see, were there more families surviving on virtually no cash? Of course, we had to figure out what does virtually no cash mean. And I've always thought, when you have to pick some sort of arbitrary line, it's better to choose somebody else's. So we borrowed inspiration from the World Bank and used this $2 a day metric. And as of 2011, there were 1.5 million households in any given month who were reporting cash incomes of no more than $2 per person per day. That was up from 600,000 in 1996, more than a doubling over a 15-year period. So I think it stunned us both. We expected to maybe see something, but not something that dramatic. So we started looking around for other sources of data. We went to the SNAP administrative rolls and looked at the number of families on SNAP who reported no cash income. Those numbers lined up quite precisely with our SIP numbers. We looked at the number of homeless children over the 2000s. We have data from the schools starting in 2004, I think, going through the present, more than a doubling of the number of homeless school children, as we saw as we got into qualitative work. That was a serious hardship. And a big increase in the take-up of emergency food assistance from charitable organizations. So across all of these indicators, we saw, I think, a consistent story of worsening conditions among the nation's poorest families. We released an initial report. It was a 5-page policy brief, probably the simplest thing I've ever done in my career. And it got a fair amount of attention, but we also got a lot of questions. Are there really families out there who have cash incomes of less than $2 per per person per day. How do they get into these circumstances if they're out there? What do they do to survive? And we thought that those types of questions needed to take us back to where the exploration started. And so we decided to go back and see if we could find families. Could we go to different places in the country and meet families who we think would register as $2 a day for in the set, and follow them and see what their experiences were. So we started in Chicago, which we think of as a quintessential American city. It was also happened to be the place where we both did graduate school. So it's always nice to know where the bars are. Gilbert. Went to Cleveland, Ohio, a very affluent place half a century ago. Its business is called it the best location in the nation. And now a very high poverty Rust Belt city. Down to the Tri-City area in the foothills of the Appalachian Mountains, a place that maybe in large part spurred the war on poverty, but actually has been doing better in recent years. And then down to the Mississippi Delta, an area that's been chronically deeply poor for a very long time. We don't want to take up too much time talking ourselves and just get to questions, but we wanted to share a couple of insights from the book that maybe surprised us or were things we really took away. One was, you know, when I saw this initial trend line of increasing families below this $2 a day mark, I was really sort of set in a developing world sort of mind frame. And I don't know, I pictured folks who were completely detached from the labor market. And what we found as we started going around the country and we really saw evidence of this back in the SIP once we knew to look for it, was that the families we met really first and foremost thought of themselves as workers. They wanted to work. And in fact, when we would ask families, if we came back in a year and you were doing well, what would it look like? None of them mentioned, I'd like a more robust cash safety net, although we think that they have that. But all of them mentioned, I know if I just had a job with stable full-time hours that paid $10 to $12 an hour, I mean with, you know, uncanny, precision, that's what people said, $10 to $12 an hour. One guy said $15 an hour, and he had sort of ideas of the savings account too. He was sort of pushing the envelope. But you know, often in the typical case would be families had been working in a job, but due to the incredible instability in the labor market and the jobs that they had available to them, the incredible slack in the low-wage labor market, especially at the time when we were interviewing, and I think instability in the family lives of families, these things sort of interacted in a very toxic way to lead families to inevitably lose a job, and things would spiral down from there. So a key dilemma was work hours. So families would have schedules that changed from week to week, and both in the timing of evening shifts and day shifts, and also in the number of hours. We'd see many families who'd have their hours reduced from one week to the next. The work conditions also, we saw many examples of clear labor law violations, failure to pay overtime for those who did get enough hours, as well as unsafe working conditions. When families lost that job, because they were at the very end of the hiring queue, it could be all but impossible to find work again. So when we met Jennifer Hernandez in Chicago, she'd been living in a succession of family homeless shelters for 10 months. And just with having an address to sort of mark you in a family homeless shelter, she really had a black mark against her for employers who had a lot of people to choose from. So not too long before we were in the field, a Walmart opened up on the south side of Chicago, and they got, I think, 24,000 applications for 400 slots. So there's a lot of people competing for these jobs. Jennifer, her phone was almost always turned off. It was more sort of a tool for games for her little ones, Caitlin and Cole. And so she'd have to use the number at the homeless shelter. So I think that's another mark against her. Somebody actually called and they have to wait for them to find Jennifer. But she finally landed a job at Chicago Custodial Services, a small family cleaning business that really wasn't that much up the economic ladder from where she was. It was a small cleaning business that it really had to compete But at first she really liked the job, and she maybe more than any of our other folks sort of talked about work as you might think of a mental health intervention, right? So she'd say, when I have a job, I have purpose. I can see that I made a contribution when I clean a room. It gives me a way to make a contribution to the world. I think a lot of the reasons why a lot of us like our job or our course of study. And we would see this over and over again. Ray McCormick in Cleveland, Ohio, he would sort of say, when I'm at work, when you talk to Ray, she'd say, I've been raped, sort of matter-of-factly. But when she was at work, it was almost like a shelter from the storm. It could turn everything. So Jennifer really liked the job at Chicago City Custodial Services. When it started, she was doing a lot of corporate apartments between leases and the office spaces in the Loop. But as the Chicago winter set in, she found herself going into more and more foreclosed homes on the south and west side of the city. So these were homes that had been shuttered for a long time. They never knew what to expect. Sometimes squatting families, sometimes a drug house. As they would go in the door, there was no heat, so they'd be working in their coats. There was no light, so they'd be working in the dark, and there was no water. And water actually ended up being a big challenge for them, that they'd have to bring their own in buckets. But you can imagine, as Jennifer said, there was a lot of dirt, a lot of cleaning that had to be done. That water would get pitch black, half an hour, 45 minutes, maybe an hour. They'd have to dump it and then go to the nearest neighbor looking for an outdoor spigot, or to the nearest gas station, sort of avert eye contact, to go into the bathroom and refill those buckets and take them back. And you can imagine sort of in the cold Chicago winter, sort of going back and forth like that multiple times over the course of the cleaning job. Well, she had asthma, and she would get sick, as she was breathing in this moldy air. She had a couple of asthma attacks, and when she would catch a virus, her kids would catch a virus, as every parent with small kids knows. And eventually, she got a housing subsidy when she got the job from the shelter she was in. And she had a few months left, and she thought, you know what, I need to quit this job. I'm going to make the decision to quit this job because I need to get well and look for the next job, because it took me 10 months to find this job. How long is it going to take to find the next?
So I want to talk a little bit about the work of survival. We're just giving you a taste of the book tonight. But I first want to say that many of you who are used to being around here have no idea what an incredible table this is, especially with the folks on my left. I started graduate school the year that Bill Wilson published The Truly Disadvantaged, and it changed and shaped the course of my career. And when I came to the Kennedy School, I found incredible inspiration in the career of David Ellwood. If you read both of my latest two books, David is a character in both. So if you want to learn more about him, go right to your Amazon.
Robert Redford's probably going to be playing.
Exactly. But it's very, very exciting to have both of them here. I spent my career studying survival strategies of poor people, but the work of survival among these folks, I think, was pretty stunning to me. I'm going to talk about four survival strategies very briefly that were the most common among the $2 a day poor. And they really are at the ragged edge of the survival strategy that I've seen people deploy over the course of my career. Because to deploy the most profitable survival strategies, you have to have a modicum of stability. And these folks really did not have that. So the most common form of survival was engaging in the one kind of barter that these folks actually could, because as it turned out, you actually couldn't survive on just $2 a day in cash. You needed to pay the utility bill, your kids needed socks and underwear. And so food stamps, although rarely traded by the just plain poor, are ubiquitously traded among the $2 a day poor, often at the loss of 40 to 50% of their value. So Alva Mae Hicks in the Mississippi Delta regularly traded away $600 of the family's food stamps to pay her heating bill in a climate that ranged from 9 degrees to 109 degrees in just 6 months. The second most common survival strategy was actually selling plasma This has really gotten under the skin of our readers, probably more than anything else, yes. And you know, what's interesting about it, it's actually the safest of the survival strategies we noted, and practically the only one that doesn't make you a felon, because of course it's a felony to trade your food stamps. And so Jessica Compton down in Johnson City, Tennessee, was really supporting her little family. Her and Travis had both seen their hours reduced to zero in the off season there. But you know, the little bit of cash they had was coming from her plasma sales. You know, a 111-pound woman who just barely passed the minimum weight requirement of 110 pounds, and tells us a poignant story about how terrified she was each time she went that her iron wouldn't be high enough, or her blood pressure wouldn't be strong enough for her to be able to give plasma. That day, the third most common strategy, scrapping, pays very poorly. It's kind of the opposite of plasma sales, where you get about $30 a time, although you're only allowed to give 10 times a month. I should say that 70% of the world's plasma comes from the U.S. We're the only country that allows plasma donations that frequently, and plasma sales have increased from 10,000 donations in 10 million donations in 2005 to 23 million in 2010, just a five-year time period of time. But anyway, in terms of scrapping, you're really only going to make about a dollar an hour unless you have a truck, and you can engage in sort of the kind of the criminal scrapping that you see you know, folks with more resources doing. Very few folks that we talked to were like that. Finally, trading sex or sexual favors for resources. So Madonna Harrison Chicago got both her storage locker paid for and her cell phone bill maintained because of a friend. And if you read the book later on, that relationship with the friend really led to a pretty serious risk for her daughter in an extended period. Another spell among the $2 a day poor. But I want to end with something optimistic, because there is a sense of optimism among the $2 a day poor that surprised me, given their level of material deprivation. Paul Heckwilder in Cleveland, Ohio, when his family business failed and he found 22 members of his extended family all doubled, tripled, and quadrupled up in his home, you know, they engaged in just in tremendous entrepreneurship to make a go of this, especially once the water was shut off and they had to spend 4 months without water in a house with 24 people, including Paul and his wife. Once I was talking with Paul kind of after the family had seen a little bit better time, we followed these families for several years, about, you know, thinking back to how he rigged up ways of catching and capturing all the rainwater so he could flush the toilet upstairs. His little granddaughter, Shawnee, said, "Grandpa, it was like pioneer days." You know, she actually had some fond memories at that time watching the family, you know, plant a victory garden with spoiled vegetables in the backyard and so on. So I'm going to end there because I'm really curious to hear what Professor Ellwood has to say.
Because what I have to say most important is really simple, but let me actually do something you're not supposed to do. Start by asking, how many people, I want you to actually raise your hands, have read this book? Okay, so my simple message is this. Every single person should read this book. And if you are a scholar or someone who studies this issue, particularly if you're not a sociologist studying this issue, like you're an economist or some other weird discipline, it is absolutely essential that you read this book. In fact, I agree with Bill, all of the books that Kat has done are in that category. And Luke, welcome to the main team. Part of the reason it's so important is that so few people who actually make and say things about poverty have never actually been anywhere close to a poor person. Knowingly. When we started on welfare reform in the Clinton administration, one of the things that Mary Jo and I insisted on, or Joe Bain was also here, was that every single person involved in our various working groups and so forth had to go and visit an intake interview in a welfare office and do a focus group with the welfare recipient. We also had to do a public hearing. Okay? That was a rule. Essentially, no one on those working groups had ever done any of those things. These were the leading experts in government. These were this was true though of the staff and the Congress. It was even true of a world famous editorial writer for the Washington Post. He said, oh, could I come on one of those? I've never done that. It just turns out that most of what you think is really stupid. And a lot of what you think is really simplistic. And so part of the reason that was critical was just, I called it brush clearing. The liberals would say, man, these people really do hate welfare. And the conservatives say, man, these people really do have hard lives. And so that's a get rid of the simple, stupid stuff. And again, books like this, and this book in particular, really give you a sense of how incredibly hard it is to be poor, and frankly, how incredibly smart you have to be to survive if you're poor. A lot of the things we all take for granted, even the comment about going for drinks or going to Dunkin' Donuts, can't afford to buy the coffee at Dunkin' Donuts even. I mean, it's really, really hard. And by the way, there are no Dunkin' Donuts nearby. There aren't even laundromats nearby. It's just a disaster. So Bill has been, you know, that's his whole life has been on this kind of stuff as well. And so those kinds of things are critical. Just one last example of that. For many years, one of the things I spent time was trying to understand the changing pattern of family structures, the number of one-parent families, and so forth. And honestly, conceptually in my mind, I thought of it kind of like this. Well, people, men and women, let's say women for a moment, are trying to decide whether to get married. And then once they decide whether to get married or not, then they decide to have kids or not. And that's kind of the conception of it. And Kathy basically came in and said, you've got that exactly backwards. People, you know, women, by and large, they want to have babies. That's especially low-income women. That's the given. You're going to do that. You might, the question is when. And then the hope is maybe you can find a man to do it. And at least someone will support you. They still want the white picket fence. And again, that doesn't sound like a very big difference, but it turned everything around, and all of a sudden, a whole bunch of things that didn't make sense made sense. And so my main point is, read the book. It's really critical. It's this kind of stuff that's essential. Let me talk about some specifics here. This book has embedded in it an interesting policy story. And the policy story kind of goes like this. A group of folks, myself included, I get to figure as a character as it in this book, went to Washington with some grand ideas. They thought the welfare system was broken, that basically we should make work pay, and so people go to work, they ought to do better, that's why the unemployment tax credit was expanded so much and so forth. And then people that weren't working should be expected to work at some point. First we try in training and so forth, but at some point the expectation is you got to go to work. But if you couldn't find a job, we'll kind of create one for you, a subsidized job or something like that. That was that kind of original plan. By the way, untalked about was also a dramatic expansion in child support, of course, which, by the way, figures quite commonly in this book, interestingly enough. And so what happened was all the make work pay stuff did happen. People said, yeah, I think everybody should focus on work. They should go to work. You should have those time limits. But the part that said that jobs would be guaranteed fell apart. And so people would hit time limits and be gone. And then in addition, quite unexpectedly, one other thing happened. The old system, which was a matching entitlement, which meant when a state spent money, they would get money for a particular program as fixed by the government. They would get matching money from the federal government. And the poorer the state, the more matching money they got. Mississippi got like $4 for every dollar they spent. So it's a good deal. And instead, we turned it into a block grant and said, you get this amount of money no matter what. Okay, that's what happened. Mary Jo and I and Wendell and others resigned. I'd already left by that time. I publicly and privately urged President to veto it because of the lack of these things. But in any case, he signed it. And you know what? the world did not come to an end. Mm-hmm. Poverty went down, tons of people went to work, single mothers had the biggest single increase in work in ever recorded. The black poverty rate was as low as you've ever seen it. It was amazing. I remember coming back and meeting with Sandy here and saying, we said, everything's going great, how can this be? I mean, there are fewer children being born out of wedlock, everything's going great. And indeed, I think the initial, my initial reaction to things and so forth was, well, it actually looked pretty good. And one of the things that the book does emphasize is that by changing the orientation towards work, both by making work pay a lot more with EITC, but also saying that really did change things. And there is a little bit of a harking in this book to the good old days when we had welfare. The good old days in welfare look a lot like, there's a character here, a woman named, named in the book, Madonna, sounds like Madonna, who goes to a welfare office and she shows up at 8, the doors open at 8:30, and they say, anyone that wasn't here by 7:30 will not get sued. And basically, Madonna's view of the world, is it Madonna?
Madonna,
okay. Madonna's view of the world is, they just shut down the welfare system, they don't want anybody on, and that's what's going on. But people back then despised the welfare system. They hated it, and they would say in their focus groups, it makes me lazy, it's just not the right thing, I want to be doing something else, and yet I fall back on it. So it wasn't this, it was a lot like it is today for Madonna. People were miserable, they treated you like dirt. You felt like the last thing they wanted to do was help you help yourself. So that was the theory. Now, then the economy collapsed, and absolutely unambiguously collapsed. And that was what all of us were afraid of anyway. That's what those jobs were for. It wasn't for when the economy was tied as a drum, it was for those jobs. And it certainly appears that the disaster that many predicted really did occur. But it's interesting also, even though to reflect, is suppose we had the old system back in, and then had this economy, it would have been a pretty desperate time as well. Because the truth is, welfare is hard to be on, it was tough, there would be some of this, but it wasn't as though life would all be rosy. My main point here is only this, and that is, there are two points here. One is, trade everything for a strong economy. A strong economy is like unbelievably important, particularly to a work-based strategy. On the other hand, if you've got a work-based strategy and you've got a weak economy, you've got a disaster on your hands. And we have a disaster on our hands. And that's pretty obvious, but it's really true. And you know, it's the nature of the political system that it can't believe the world is going to get worse ever. It just really, really terrible things have happened. And the fact is, welfare, Bill Clinton talked about ending welfare as we know it. He could have just skipped the as we know it part, because that's more or less where we're at in most states now. I should also point out, by the way, the one thing that I disagree slightly in the book about the policy story here was that Mary Jo and Bruce Reed and I and others and so forth put together a bill that the book describes as essentially dead on arrival. That's not how it felt at all. It came in the summer before the Republicans took over. And Moynihan was very supportive. The Democrats were actually quite anxious to do something because that was, they were starting to sense, we got a restless public here and it's very tough. The people who stopped it were the liberal Democrats, Bob Matsui in particular. And that's because the bill was way too conservative. The notion that someone who was able to work but not willing to work should be cut off was offensive to him. And interestingly enough, he did everything he could, including attacking me quite vociferously, to stop it and succeeded. And so I don't know for sure. It was late, time was tight. On the other hand, there was a lot of desire to get something done. So I have no idea how close we came to that or not. But I'm also not sure it would have lasted or worked all that well either. You have no idea how hard it was to talk the Clinton administration into having some sort of jobs. So wait a minute. They'll be the only people besides you professors that have guaranteed jobs for life? Well, that wasn't really what I was talking about. Point is only this, it's a hard game when you're there, and good ideas sometimes end up with bad outcomes, and there's much good that came from it and a lot of bad that we're dealing with right now. But I also don't harken back to the good old days. The good old days were really bad too. And that's partly just because we treat poor people like they're not people. So that brings me to the last point, which is, okay, let's think about the future. It has, much to its credit, this book has a serious policy chapter at the end. Most scholars write a paragraph at the end saying more money is needed or more studies necessary. And here I'm a little more discouraged than I am. I would, as I say, trade everything for a phenomenal economy. But I think the story, not only with this poorest of the poor, in fact, in some ways, this felt like a story of ordinary, regular poor, as it were. Work is really bad, especially in a bad economy, but even in a good economy, you lose your job. There are many of these jobs are jobs you just don't not show up one day. You don't care what the story is. You don't show up, that's it, that's the end. It's a horrible story, and it's about a woman who was a cashier for 8 years. People loved her. One day, her cash was $20 short, and they fired her. Bang! They found the money, but she was still fired. I mean, that's the kind of, she loved the job, and they loved her, but that's the way it works. But you've also got families that are really, really difficult. First of all, in this book, children kind of magically arise every so often, but those are actions and decisions and so forth. In addition, we have men coming in and out of the household. We have multiple, living with multiple adults just trying to survive. So the family situation is incredibly unstable. The housing situation, imagine trying to raise a kid when every 3 months you're kicked out of a homeless shelter because you haven't become self-sufficient. Health is, again, just a constant source, and you heard some of it. And finally, frankly, financial management skills aren't exactly, they're more comparable to Kathy's and mine, as opposed to what we might think, hope people's. You put all those things together, and fixing one thing doesn't fix it all. Jobs would help, okay? A strong economy would help, but it doesn't solve education, it doesn't solve, I didn't mention education, I mean, they all feed back on each other, and so often we try and do these single-edged policy swords that, you know, you're disappointed in it, because it turns out there's five different things going on. And I think one of the great challenges for all of you is to figure out what the next dramatic reform looks like, because it's not going to look, I don't think, like what was the fantasy or whatever, the plan that was hoped for in the Clinton era. It's going to have to look like some way to bring those folks together, because one of the other things we've learned in the interim, this is from people like the Sendel Mullane thing and Edler Shaefer, is what we all should know, which is when we're stressed because there's so many different things going on, every human being just sort of says, screw the future, I'm going to get through this. I don't care if it'd be easier if I learned how to do the computer, just fix it. I don't care, I just do it. And that's, in this extreme state, you know, there's really no way to do effective planning for the future, even if you could sit down and know exactly what to do. So I think it's going to be an interesting challenge, but I also think it's going to mean we're going to cross the streams. It's why the inequality program and other here is so critical. I think it's going to take mixing together practitioners and scholars. I think it's going to take mixing together the economists and sociologists and psychologists and everyone else to find a way where we can seriously make it possible to do what is now basically impossible for these families. I don't think if you read these stories, you'll come away thinking, gee, in 5 years' time, it's going to be a ton better. It's really discouraging. I don't think you're going to look at any of these families and say, gee, in a liberal state, it would be a ton better. A liberal state with a great economy, and maybe, but I think it's a much more basic set of issues that we're going to have to all work on. And so I look forward to their next book on what we do with it.
Before we open it up for questions, you guys want to respond to David?
I just have one comment, and that is, you know, I studied welfare in the old days, and I would completely agree with you. This was the, there's a welfare office, an old welfare office on in Eastie, right? It's just off the main drag, they're off Maverick, and, you know, it's a, like a Dickensian building with you know, big brass letters over the door, overseers of the public welfare. You know, there's wire mesh on the windows, and that building is really symbolic of what welfare was. It was a place that excluded. It was a place that made non-citizens. It was a place that divided. When Sarah Halpern Meekin and Laura Tack and Jen Sykes, all graduates of the inequality program, and I decided to study the EITC and recipients of the EITC, we found ourselves at H&R Block, and here these same people that had been in one era walking through the doors on Maverick Street were now on Bennington Street, you know, walking into a building that had signs saying, "You've got people," and people greeting them with a smile. And in fact, filing your taxes was like a mark of citizenship. It was about inclusion. And the way, you know, basically these two programs both pay roughly the same amount of money, but with the EITC, you get to keep your earnings. And the way people felt about getting those two kinds of benefits was so dramatically different. It just really changed the way I thought about things. And Laura Tocken and I wrote an editorial in January in the New York Times calls When Taxes Aren't a Drag about this powerful sense of inclusion. And what Luke and I would like to do next is actually figure out whether there is a way to test the thesis that if you bring dignity and inclusion into more social problems, you can actually make better use of the marginal welfare dollar, not only improving the lives of individuals, but also communities through civic engagement and voting, and even in our democracy. So that's our humble next goal.
And, I'll be the younger, maybe more optimistic one, although I've figured out my students no longer think I'm young. I you know, in terms of taking the next step and doing something, and what do those social policies look like, I don't know what the whole package looks like, but I'm pretty sure increasing the number of jobs at the bottom is at the center of it, because I think everything else has to sort of come off of that. And it goes back to this sort of notion of dignity that it's what our families want, if nothing else. And I do think a lot of the social policy, the changes that we made in the 1990s sort of helped that get to the point where it is. Maybe I'm somewhat pessimistic in that I usually think things won't happen in Washington or maybe at the state level, but I must say that I think the conversation around the notion of programs that would seriously take a look at this has changed, at least in the last few years that I've been working on it. In Michigan, we had a Republican Governor Rick Snyder pass through a Republican legislature a $10 million program that they partner with businesses to create new jobs for structurally unemployed individuals, and then provide wraparound services to help people deal with crisis moments and get the supports they need to keep that job. And the thing I like about this program, I haven't seen anywhere else, is that they require that you pay a living wage and that you provide full-time hours. And now they want to scale that up and try to take it around the country, and they've got a lot of positive reception to that. So maybe there's, you know, some glimmers that we can make some moves in positive directions, just as in the 1990s, I think we did. There was a lot of good things that we did, and certainly the EITC is much better than the old welfare system. It just happens not to be an actual safety.
Good. We have a few minutes remaining for questions.
Thanks. Okay, so yeah, it is true, of course, as you and others have noted, that you want to increase the number of employment opportunities for lower-income American citizens. And so that would seem to indicate and be another powerful reason on why we need to crack down on illegal immigration, which has been a constant source of competition for these exact same sorts of jobs. I mean, there are many other good reasons as well, but that also is contributing to the lack of opportunity for many lower-class American citizens.
You know, I guess I can take a stab, although there may be people in the room that are can answer this with more authority than me, but we were in parts of the country, mainly, I mean, Chicago somewhat, but especially in the other parts of the country, there's very little inflow of immigrants. So, my understanding is that maybe inflows of population affect certain small sections of the country, but it's not what's driving the problems at its core. My reading of literature is not.
The only thing I'd add to that is Mary Waters, a faculty member in sociology, led a phenomenal National Academy of Sciences panel, and I think they've released their report now, and I would just commend that report to you. I think it's fair and very smart.
Bruce? Two questions. One is, I want to sort of push on David's concluding point a bit. I wonder how much you believe it, actually, David, that we need to bring economists together with sociologists, and it's programs like the inequality program that can make a really valuable contribution to policy knowledge that can help us solve this problem. Is the problem that we don't have the policy knowledge, or we don't have the political will actually to provide a more robust solution? So I look at Western Europe and there isn't the same severity and harshness and brutality in European poverty as there is in America. And this is, I think, one of the vivid contributions of the book. And so do they have better policy knowledge, or is there a stronger political consensus there about how the most disadvantaged should be treated? And so how do we think about, how do you guys think about the political challenges of building support for a different kind of political program? That's the first issue. The second one, quickly, is this is too long-winded. The second one is about the importance of employment, and so we're talking in many cases about young women with young single women with small children, and we want them to work more. And so my question is, well, what happens to their kids? And particularly if they're on $12 an hour, who is taking care of their kids? So are we just talking about more $12 jobs for very low-skill young women, or are we thinking about a policy world in which there are other sort of social supports in place as well that were on the table when welfare reform was first being discussed, and what would they look like? What needs to be in place to support this effort of increased employment among young, low-skilled women with small children?
You should start.
Okay, so I think you should all reread Poor Support. And so this is a book David wrote.
That would triple the sales.
It's a phenomenal book. And if you've been in my class, I see some of the alums of my Kennedy School class here. You've read Poor Support, and you know that Ellwood really calls for a set of social policies that are consistent with American values. And as I was doing the research for EITC with Laura, Jen, and Sarah, it just became so palpably clear to me that this was the right way forward. In some ways, I think we need to rethink the safety net almost from the ground up to think about creating political will. The EITC is a tremendously successful program. We spend now $70 billion on a program that, David and his colleagues snuck into the tax code surreptitiously. And although every once in a while somebody takes issue with it, it has enjoyed pretty remarkable political support, whereas only $5 billion now is going into the pockets of TANF recipients. So I think the record shows that Americans are actually willing to spend a lot on the poor, and in fact, you see this in surveys, but they're not willing to support
policies that are inconsistent with American values. So I think what gives me hope is the idea of really rethinking the safety net in ways that do pay attention to these values. And here's the potential win. We don't have to have two categories of people, citizens and non-citizens, but everybody gets to be a citizen. You know, I grew up, in a Republican family who then became Democratic and was fairly liberal, I think, and still am. But hanging out with these families really made me much more receptive, I think, to the message and core support in this Ellwood playbook move. I think is really where we need to go, and I don't think we know what political will we might muster if we rethought the safety net along those lines.
Could I just weigh in here? So, David, you pointed out that AFDC had many, many problems. I agree. But despite all its shortcomings, there would be less extreme poverty today if we had AFDC. Now, here's the point. This book is about extreme poverty. And it would be great, Bruce, if we had a job program that combined adequate child care so that mothers wouldn't have to worry about their children. But people are trying to survive. The first step is jobs. And I pick up on a recommendation you guys made. Public sector employment for people who can't find jobs in their private sector. Now, you say, well, in this political climate, no one's going to seriously consider that. I'm not so sure. I think that there could be support for a public sector jobs program in areas with the highest jobless rates, where a lot of these people are concentrated. I wouldn't dismiss that possibility, especially if we have a new administration. Yes.
Yeah, thank you so much for your speech. Actually, on his point, one thing I didn't really understand was like the Scandinavian family had a very strong tradition of egalitarian policy. And when the Danish Prime Minister came, he spoke very properly about that. I just don't really understand what it is, or what it's so uniquely American about inequality, because it just doesn't square. I'm from Singapore, it's one of the most unequal countries in Asia as well, and I don't understand why my government is one. So that's one. Second thing is, the question I have is regarding the lack of relevant skills for people in low-income families, especially in the advent of technological innovation. The reason I'm saying that is that you look at Uber, there's Travis Kalanick and there's a Uber driver. If you look at, and right now I'm doing an MBA at Stanford, there's a huge dichotomy between the have and have-nots in the tech sector, which is playing an increasingly important role in our lives. And the more technically sophisticated jobs are, which is the trend that is moving towards, programming is becoming now, at least Kennedy School recognize it as a language for the electives. So, how do you foresee the guys at the low end of the totem pole catching up when there's so much ground that's already being lost, especially with the other groups?
So back to the childcare question, I'll go here. I just wanted to say the childcare actually was not as much the ubiquitous concern that at least I expected. I think in a lot of cases schools played a role, and then there was sometimes some family situations might be really bad, so I think that's a concern. But I think when I'm thinking about wraparound services, I actually want it to be pretty flexible, right? So I want somebody who will actually work with people and say, what do you need to stay in this job, and try to figure that out. And I actually think that helps cut our costs and versus sort of saying, okay, here's the childcare because we know you need childcare. Well, some people need childcare, but other people might just need transportation because they actually have good childcare. So, I think trying to, if we can actually create a program that's support services that are more flexible, I think it'll be more more effective. Now, to the skills question, you know, I think low-skilled jobs is the core challenge of the 21st century, and it's not just for the extreme poor. It's, you know, way up the economic ladder. I think of, you know, what does work look like for folks in this country. Interestingly, I was talking to a guy who runs a Youth Build Massachusetts today, and Youth Build puts low-skilled and often folks coming back out of the prison system to work building new homes and rehabbing new homes. And I said, gosh, you know, you're taking a, you know, your typical guy who's coming into Youth Build probably doesn't have a high school degree. It must be really hard to teach them how to build houses. And he said, actually, that's not the hard part. The hard part is sort of the actual soft skills. I can teach anybody to sort of rehab a house. And then he said something that I thought was true, and it's always nice to have that. You have that positive confirmation bias, right? Which was in a 7-year program with XFN, you know, that has all these folks, all these guys coming back out of prison, they reduce their recidivism rate to 5%. The typical, and I'm not sure what the typical, in Michigan, I think recidivism in 1 year is about 15%. Maybe that number is low, but I mean, there's a huge savings there. And there's a jobs program for ex-offenders or formerly incarcerated in New York, and they've done the benefit cost analysis, and it pays for itself. So I think, you know, it pays for itself simply by reducing recidivism. It's cost neutral in a randomized trial. So, you know, I think with this discussion, we just have to think more holistically about the benefits to society. But I'm sort of less, I'm more optimistic that we can actually, there are things that make a positive contribution to society, like rehabbing houses or building new houses, that we can train people that we think of as low-skilled to do relatively quickly and to do well.
Okay. We're supposed to end at what, 6:30? I mean, 7:30? Take one more question from Sandy, and then that's it.
Well, I can only ask two questions, but I'll make them very short.
Okay.
The first one is for David. The unemployment rate is around a little above 5%, which we used to regard as pretty good these days. And I'm wondering, you know, of course, you know, we all know there are all those discouraged workers out there, and so, but I'm still wondering to myself, what does the unemployment rate have to be to produce a good economy that's going to not that far from that number, but I would see one slide. What do you think? My question for Kathy is very different, but I'm hoping you can answer. The conditions that made people treat people who wanted to get on welfare up there don't appear to be imposed by Republicans.
Sandy, could you talk just a little louder?
Oh, okay. The conditions that lead the welfare workers who are on the ground in the storage hotels treat those recipients the way they treat them aren't a direct product of the law or the ill will of Republican voters or something. And I'm trying to figure out what would it take to change the actual workings of these organizations so that they treated people better rather than just, you know, what would it take to change the hearts and minds of Republicans, which I think is an unpromising
idea. So quickly, Dave.
So your first one is, I wish I knew, that's why I'm no longer dean or what, trying to figure out those things, although I would say, let's try 3 years of 4 to 4.5 to 5.5% unemployment, and hopefully things will start to look a little better. Obviously, much of your work was done a couple years ago. It's not going to be enough, but it's a necessary first step, and then I think you start thinking about other strategies as well. And on the only other part I would just say is, you know, as well, one of the things I found when I spent much more time in the field and not less time on my computer, still my first love, was that the problem wasn't the culture of poverty, it was the culture of welfare offices. They sent messages constantly that a good welfare recipient didn't work. And they also send messages that anybody that's here is not a good person. So you put those two together, that's really not a good strategy for getting people on their way. And the interesting thing is that there's a lot of evidence right after welfare reform passed that offices started to change. That people were focused on work, people enjoyed coming in, people would come in, and that they, because they had flexibility, and at that point the states hadn't stolen all the money yet, you could say, look, we've got all these supports for you. We can give you childcare. Mississippi was offering lots more childcare money. Whoa, what does that mean? So I think people actually prefer to work in those kind of environments as well. So I think that if you put together the right pieces, it could conceivably help. But I think when you make caseloads insanely high and give them no money, and you think about what child protective services looks like, it's just
quickly, but wouldn't you also add the problem of involuntary part-time work, which is a major problem now, even with 5% unemployment, non-labor force participation, and people who have dropped out of the labor market altogether? So
yeah,
what we're talking about is the jobless rate, not just the unemployment rate.
So how do you change how caseworkers treat clients? You know, it's not just welfare offices. You go to the nation's food banks and you see a lot of the same thing. You even go to church basements where they're giving out food. I go to church, so it's really, I'm not picking on churches, but oftentimes you see the same kind of distancing and stigmatizing behavior. Michael Lipsey, of course, has written the classic treatise on why this is. His theory is that, you know, when good people are faced with a sea of need and very limited resources, the only way to sort of resolve your cognitive dissonance is to blame your clients for their own shortcomings. And you know, Luke and I have been hanging around some really needy people over the last 3 years, and sometimes we feel these impulses when it's just so crushing. To your point, David, how much these families really need. But I am encouraged by my months hanging out at the H&R Block office. You know, what a different model, right? We also see different levels of stigma imposed in different kinds of welfare offices. So if you go to the WIC office, you see much less stigma imposed than you do in the welfare office, or even with the SNAP program, in part because people code it as a nutrition program and an education program. You would think that families would rail against the fact that they get weighed and measured and told how to feed their kids, but instead, my work with the USDA in 9 cities across America has shown that they welcome it because it's not a welfare program, it's an educational program. So I remain hopeful that we can really change this culture by changing the way these things are coded. If they're seen as earned, if they're seen as educational, if they're seen as part of being part of the fabric of America, I think we can do much better for our poor citizens.
Okay.
Read his book.
Right.